Many thanks for staying on Joy News today. In our first business story, government will from next week begin the process of issuing the country's first 10-year cedi bond. This will be the first time the state is trying to raise funds over such a period. But at what price, and how will this impact government's rising expenditure and cost of borrowing? George Riafi has more.
Government is hoping to raise the funds through three institutions. That is Finance House, SAS, Barclays and Stanbic Bank. These firms are expected to engage investors to ensure they're able to raise the targeted amount and at a favorable cost. Even though government is silent on the expected amount to be raised, the bond and treasury bill calendar issued earlier this year shows that the state is planning to raise some 200 million Ghana cedis. It is expected to settle on the rate at which it raises these funds, possibly next week. But looking at the about 17 to 18% interest paid on the last 7-year bond, industry watchers are of the view that the state could get a lower rate than this. Government had in the past complained about the time taken to pay back funds borrowed. Therefore, going this way could help the state borrow long-term funds for infrastructure projects in order to free up the short-term space for private firms. However, some are worried about the impact of this bond issuance on the rising public debt and expenditure. Government is planning to raise some 60 billion Ghana cedis through bond and treasury bills this year. The public debt has also hit 110 billion Ghana cedis as of July this year.
The civil society platform for oil and gas is demanding the Auditor General's department conducts an audit on projects funded with oil revenue. This, according to the group, is critical to ensure the country derives maximum value for money in these initiatives. More in this Business Desk report.
Government in its annual budget allocates substantial amounts of oil revenue for projects across various sectors. Chairman of the Civil Society Platform for Oil and Gas, Dr. Steve Mantel, however, says the status of a number of the projects leaves much to be desired.
The primary underlying factor has to do with the issue of poor monitoring, poor supervision in the execution of oil-funded projects. As I highlighted in my presentation, some side vessels undertaken by the Public Interest and Accountability Committee this year has revealed that some of the projects funded with oil money in actual fact do not exist, even though monies have been expended. By and large, you find that the regional administration often is not aware of the fact that there are oil-funded projects in the region. At the district level, even where the district authorities are aware, they are not involved in the monitoring of the projects. And so there's no effective supervision, no monitoring, and that is what for me largely accounts for these phantom and poorly executed projects. The first remedial step to take will be for the Auditor General's Department to undertake a value for money audit of all oil-funded projects in this country. And where monies have been abused, we'll allow the law to take its course. First, we retrieve the monies and mete out the necessary sanctions. Going forward, we'll need to involve the beneficiary communities in the monitoring and supervision of the projects. There's a role for me, in my view, to be played by the local authorities. But even the civil society groups on the ground can also support the monitoring efforts if they are given adequate project information. And that is how, in my view, we'll be able to get the best of these oil-funded projects.
This, according to him, only calls for a deepening of monitoring and evaluation mechanisms with requisite sanctions. Projects that were monitored had been captured in the annual report of PIEC as having received funding in either 2014 or 2015.
That's all for business news in this edition of Joy News Today.